Hi, everybody. I'm Steve Saunders in for Lauren Servin. Today on Healthy Alternatives, we have Maggie Downey here. She is from Personal Euphoria in town. How are you doing?
I'm good. It's nice to be here.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's your first time here at the studio.
Yeah, it's a great space. Weathersfield has a good little program here.
Yeah, it's great to serve here for sure. So tell me about your company in town and what you do.
Sure. Well, Personal Euphoria, I started it in 2007, and we offer primarily Pilates classes. So in town in Old Weathersfield, I run a small private studio out of my home, and we have the Pilates equipment, so the reformer, the chair, the ladder barrel, things that everybody might not have heard of, but it's some fun equipment that you can do some work on. But then primarily we offer Pilates classes at a more affordable rate than a lot of local studios through Parks and Rec. So we're in the Weathersfield Parks and Rec department and some other local town Parks and Recs as well.
Okay, so and that must be in the catalog somewhere for the town.
Normally in the Park and Rec brochure. Yeah.
Okay.
Or on our website. All our classes are listed on the Person Euphoria website, so you can see all our towns and the days they run and things like that.
Oh, very good. Maybe we can get that up at some point. We'll put it on the show. Talk to me about Pilates. For someone that like me, who doesn't know much about that at all, tell me a little bit about what that is.
Sure. Well, Pilates is a form of exercise, very basically. It typically gets clumped in with yoga. People who don't know Pilates will think it's pretty much the same thing as yoga. But while there's different types of yoga, yoga tends to be a lot more stretching. And Pilates, we're really more about core strength. So when people hear that buzzword core, everybody likes that because we all want six-pack abs. But in Pilates, your core to us is not just your abs. We consider your core your abs, your back, your butt, and your shoulder girdle. So your whole trunk, basically. We want to make that strong and stable so that you can move your limbs flexibly and limberly. So I always say the best example is a tree. You've got a strong trunk, and then the branches can blow in the breeze and stay attached to the tree, and everything can function smoothly.
Okay. You know what? We actually went to your house over the last summer, which is a beautiful house, by the way.
Thank you.
Yeah. But what I remember the most out of that was you were teaching Lauren how to kind of suck in her gut. I'm not really sure how to say it, but, you know, and I did that for a couple weeks after that, thinking that, you know, this is kind of neat. So what is that?
Well, that's a good way to start. And the great thing about Pilates is you can do Pilates if you are basically sucking in your gut, although we don't say that. So,
don't blame you.
only because, one, it might turn people off, but also because it's not as, like, intense as that. Like, if you really suck in your gut, it almost feels like you can't breathe, right? So it's more if you think of, start with your belly button because that's not the top abs up here, but it's higher than your lowest abdominals. Mm-hmm. And so it's a little easier to feel. If you were to think of, if you let your stomach just completely hang out, so like anyone watching at home who doesn't have anybody watching them can relax their stomach completely, they're not in public, right? And then you think of scooping your belly button just a little, and a little bit more, and a little bit more, a little bit more, and a little bit more. Mm-hmm. So you can break your engagement into five different levels. Mm-hmm. You would want to be holding your belly button in at level two all the time. So you're on level two if you're going up an elevator instead of the fifth floor. So you're not sucked in an extreme all the time, but you're gently engaged, and that will work your whole abdominals. It comes from your deepest level of abs, layer of abs. So you have your six pack out here, and then the obliques, which some people have heard of. And then beneath that, you have a muscle that runs around you like a corset, and it helps stabilize your pelvis. So when you do that gentle scoop, you're working that muscle, and it helps you sit up taller. You know, it's good for everyone's posture in our world where we're all here all day.
Sure,
you know?
I'm already sitting like that. I feel like I gotta straighten up.
Well, I said that too. I'm a Pilates teacher, but I looked at myself and I said, "Wow, I gotta sit up tall tonight."
Definitely. So, what's the balance with Pilates between using a machine? Because you talked about the machines that Joseph Pilates invented, and versus doing the techniques that you were just talking about. Is there a balance, and do you kind of do it all at once when you're using?
Well, I mean, it depends what you're doing. Like in our studio, we'll be on the equipment probably most of the time because not everyone has that equipment at home, and so they come to a studio to be able to use that. But the great thing about the equipment is it has such a huge range. You know, I work with a number of people with lots of injuries. You know, they can't get down on the floor, or they have knee issues, or they can't lift their head off the floor if they're down, or they can't move their arms for some reason or another. So it gives you a lot of options for that. But then I also have some very fit clients who come, and you can make it really challenging. You have a spring system, so you can set different weights basically on the equipment. And then for most of our towns, since we can't travel with it.
Right.
We are lying on the floor most of the time on a mat. And pluses and minuses to that, right? Like if an exercise is challenging, I can't make it much easier for you, right, with springs and weights and changing settings. Mm-hmm. I can give you modifications, but there's only so much variable, you know? But the mat is very traditional Pilates, and in a lot of ways, if you do well in a mat class, you're gonna do great once you learn the exercises on the reformer. Like, to me, the mat is true Pilates.
Okay. Now, is there any, I don't know how else to say it, evolution with Pilates? Has it changed over the years? And do you kind of come up with your own technique or exercise?
That's actually a really good question.
Yeah.
And I would say that the answer is yes, but that's dependent on who you're certified through. So there are certification programs that strictly follow what Joseph Pilates taught. You do these exercises in this order all the time, and some of them won't even modify. If you don't do the exercise, you don't do it yet, and you wait until you can do it. I'm trained through a certification program called STOT. They work with physical therapists, and so we offer lots of modifications. They have the original repertoire, and they've added and built off of that quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And then I've made up some of my own exercises. Recently, a couple of months ago, we had a fun sort of game on Facebook where we asked all of our clients to come up with a new name that they would think would be a funny Pilates exercise, and then our staff voted on the best name, and fittingly, since it's somewhat close to St. Patrick's Day, someone had picked the Fighting Irish, and
awesome.
So then I designed an exercise called the Fighting Irish, and we do it in our classes now.
Fantastic.
The way I think of it, there are five basic principles in Pilates. It has to do with your neck placement, shoulder placement, abs, pelvis, and the way you're breathing.
Mm-hmm.
If you incorporate all of those into anything, you can be doing Pilates. So any exercise you've ever thought of, if you think of these things and how they connect and cue them properly, you're doing Pilates.
Interesting. Let's talk about breathing. I mean, that's interesting. How important is breathing with Pilates?
Well, I would say breathing is important to stay alive. So
right.
Whether you're doing Pilates or not, right?
Right, gotta breathe.
But we don't. We are a society that, like, we hold our breath when we're nervous, we hold our breath when we're thinking, we
mm-hmm.
hold our breath when we're exercising. And we tend not to take deep breaths. You know, if you watch a newborn baby breathe, that belly goes up and down.
Mm-hmm.
If you watch an adult breathe, very often their chest lifts up and down, and your lungs come all the way down here. So we don't tend to breathe well in our world. You know, we're staying alive, but not as invigorated as we could be,
right,
you know?
Right.
And Pilates teaches you a whole different breath. It's different than yoga. It's very awkward and it takes time to get, but it's partly you're breathing into the sides and back of your rib cage. So you're trying to bring the breath into your sides and back, as opposed to like a belly breath, so that
mm-hmm.
you can keep that gentle second floor engagement of the abs.
Okay. Interesting.
And to me, like, I think the yoga belly breath is great. It's a good relaxing exercise. It's a nice deep breath. But it's also nice to be able to change and control and work different muscles when you want to,
mm.
you know?
Interesting. Let's talk about your workshops. You have a number of workshops, and if you want to expound on those.
Yes, you know? I'm really excited. This year, I partnered with Kate Vallone from Evolution Pilates.
Mm-hmm.
It's a studio in South Windsor and Glastonbury in Hartford. And we've worked together for a while, and we've talked for years about wanting to make Pilates more relevant to people, because that was one thing Joe Pilates, who created Pilates, always wished more people did it, and thought that if you did Pilates, you should be thinking about it in your daily life. So we thought, well, how can we incorporate it easily for people into their daily lives?
Sure.
So we started this year with creating three workshops. We first ran a workshop for runners, some of the best exercises to keep you safe while running. And then a couple weeks ago, we ran a workshop on feet. Because I could come here and talk to you for a whole hour on feet and fascia. These are my new two fascinations.
Fantastic. You have another show.
I know, right? On feet.
Yes.
And, you know, all these workshops are new to us. So in doing them, we were both a little nervous. How would they be received?
Mm-hmm.
You know, were we giving people the right information? You know, what group would show up? Would people, you know, who had a lot of foot injuries show up, or people who, you know, didn't know anything about their feet, or would we get podiatry, you know, who was going to be here and what would their level of knowledge be? But when we did this workshop a couple of weeks ago, it was really rewarding. People with a lot of pain felt that they'd had relief in their feet for the first time. And we just gave, you know, exercises for if you have bunions or plantar fasciitis, which is really common. Mm-hmm. And it starts in your foot, but it trickles up the body. So a lot of people in our world have foot issues, and we're trying to teach them skills so that they can, you know, have a better life. We have to stand. We have to walk. We're walking creatures. And so building off that foot workshop, we then designed a walking workshop, which is coming up in April. And we're really excited about this one. It's a harder sell, because the first time I told my clients we're offering a workshop, someone said to me, I've been walking 50 years, now you're going to teach me how to walk? But we're really going to give people the tools to walk with a better gait. You know, we're not going to have anybody come in and say, like, hey, you're walking wrong, this is the way to walk. We're going to talk about proper mechanics so that people can hopefully build to a better gait, and then give you exercises that will help muscles to strengthen the muscles that support your pelvis so you can walk more smoothly. Mm-hmm. Because actually, not to say people walk wrong, but especially women, right? If you've ever walked down the street and you see a woman swaying her hips from side to side.
Sure, the classic, yeah.
Yeah, right. And we've been taught that. We've grown up and we've seen other people do it, and mm-hmm. we probably do it because we think it's a little sexy, but it's not good for your pelvis. It's not good for your hip flexors in the front of your hips.
Not that I've ever swung my hips around.
No. Well, you should try it sometimes.
Okay, I'll give it a shot after the show.
And sometimes I think just wearing heels, it changes the way you walk, and you're, you know, mm-hmm. some women might have to sway their hips a little bit in a high heel. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's the way we are. We're not going to take that out of our culture right away. But when you walk, you know, when you walk with a poor gait, you're actually, they think, only using about 20% of your muscles when you're walking.
Interesting. Huh.
If you walk properly, you use about 80% of your muscles. Mm. So that's a huge difference, you know? And that means when you're walking and you're walking properly, you burn more calories, your metabolism goes up.
Wow.
For doing the same distance, and your body's in less pain. Joints are at ease. Things are happier in your body, you know?
So adjusting the gait and how you walk could actually increase your metabolism. In a sense.
You know, and I don't know if the research would say that, like, it would permanently increase it, but it's
right.
like while you're walking or any type of exercise, yeah, mm-hmm. you're going to be using bigger muscles, because when you walk, we should be your butt muscles, your glutes should be working, and we are a society that tend to work the front of our bodies more.
Okay.
So our hip flexors, the butt is the biggest muscle in your body. If you use it, that's a huge energy burner, mm-hmm. you know? So if we could get people to start to think about that a little bit more, or be aware even when they're walking. You know, you could take a walk here around Old Weathersfield. It's a beautiful place to walk. Look at the old houses, take 10 minutes of your walk and start to think, what am I feeling in my body? And, you know, in this world where we're so stressed and we need to meditate, you're kind of meditating but getting a gain from it in addition about learning something about your body, and you haven't had to sit there and take 10 minutes to go home, you know, if that's not
right.
your thing.
Right,
you know?
Right. We're talking about walking, too. It's not like it's some hardcore, you know, exercise or anything. Well, I guess you can consider it that, but
right. Well, you know,
it's
and some power walkers might, yeah. but no, that's the thing. Anybody
yeah.
can walk. So if you are an avid walker, this workshop is beneficial because you can improve your skills and get more out of your walk.
Mm-hmm.
If you're someone who's not walking a lot now but thinking of starting, this is a good workshop because it's going to give you proper skills. And again, I wouldn't want anyone to be scared. Everyone should go out and walk. Like, I wouldn't want people to, you know, go away from this and be like, I don't walk right. I'm going to hurt myself. Walk, 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 and then just start to learn some of the exercises. That will naturally help you, you know, move better when you're walking.
Mm-hmm.
I love to walk around here. It's one of the reasons we bought a house here, is we would come and we would walk. And so Matt and I took a 5-mile walk this, I think it was Sunday. It was a beautiful day, and we walked 5 miles around the green and back home. And there was a 12-year-old girl walking in front of us for a bit, who, you know, if you think of your feet, you should be walking, you know, on the ball of your feet. Her feet were so turned in that she was walking on the sides of
oh,
her
wow.
shoes.
Mm.
She's 12, she's excited, she's fun, but I will be shocked if she doesn't have knee problems, ankle problems later in life. And these are things, you know, you don't know, you know? And she's walking and strolling down the street in shoes that are very, you know, not supportive and things like that. So.
Right. Hmm. You know, I have a pair of sneakers in the closet that are slanted like what you're talking about. And I actually have to get new sneakers every couple months because that's how I hold my feet, I guess, when I'm walking.
Your feet roll in like this.
They do, and my shoes end up slanted like that because I wear out one side over the other, you know?
Yeah, and that's where the foot workshop was really interesting. We kind of talked about that kind of stuff. You know, that's actually, if your feet roll in this way, like the balls of the feet face away from each other, that's mm-hmm. called pronating your feet. And if you turn in this way towards the spine, it's called supinating.
Okay.
And we all tend to one way or the other. But again, we taught in our foot workshop little exercises you can do. Like you would really want to strengthen your arch. And so there are exercises you can do, like just sitting down here, feet flat on the floor, and without lifting the balls of your feet, lift all 10 toes. Mm. And that's an exercise that would be great for you. It would start to strengthen the arch of your foot.
Right.
And if you're rolling into it, like, do you have flat feet?
I think so. There's not much of an arch underneath there.
Yeah, which is why, you know, chicken or the egg, but that's what causes that.
Interesting.
So lifting those 10 toes, and you can play with it, you know, it might be awkward right now, but start to feel like when you lift your 10 toes, do you feel a little lift in your arch?
Because I'm trying it right
connected.
Now, actually. I can tell. Yeah. Interesting.
Yep.
Really cool.
So that's the kind of stuff that was in our foot workshop. And in our walking workshop, there'll be some overlap because it's so connected.
Your feet to walk.
Yes, so, exactly.
Right.
But we'll be talking about the pelvis a little bit more, too. There'll be a lot more hip action in there.
Okay. Talk to me about the 2020 function.
All right. 2020 function. And it's been an exciting year for Personal Euphoria.
Yeah, a lot. Yeah.
So 2020 Function is a new program and a new business that I started with two of our Pilates instructors.
Mm-hmm.
So what we've done is we've created different fitness programs that we're also running through the town. Right now, 2020 Function Cardio Funk is being offered in Wethersfield. And I'm pretty sure all our Wethersfield classes, by the way, start the first week of April. So our Pilates and our 2020 Function.
Coming up.
Yep.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. But what it is it's a good workout, a little bit of cardio, and some resistance training in 40 minutes. So hopefully you can get here after work, or if we're offering it at a lunch hour, get there on your lunch hour, in and out, in back home in an hour, and you've gotten your cardio work and your resistance training.
Wow.
And this year what we did was we created the cardio funk, so it's dancing with resistance.
Wow.
And then we're in the process of designing kicking core, which is 20 minutes of kickboxing, 20 minutes of core exercises, gentle stretch, which is 20 minutes of stretching and 20 minutes of balance challenges, blast it, 20 minutes of interval training, well, it's 40 minutes of interval training, 20 minutes on, 20 minutes off, switching each time, and have a ball, which is 20 minutes on the ball and 20 minutes of sort of fun games you might have played in gym class when you were a kid. So just making exercise more like being on a playground. But those are all to come in all of our towns, and we're really excited about it. And we're all thinking of it from, again, that like concept of the basic principles of Pilates, is your belly engaged? So you'll hear more Pilates-related cues, but in other types of movement.
Now, is this new this year, this program?
The company started in June of last year, so we're in our first year.
Oh, God,
but,
okay. Yeah,
yep.
Congratulations.
So pretty new. Yeah, it's exciting.
Awesome. You're hitting that one-year mark coming up.
So. We will be there before we know it,
wow,
I think.
Unreal.
So
that's awesome. Very cool. And you offer private classes as part of Personal Euphoria as well?
Yes. Again, that's in the Wethersfield studio over in Old Wethersfield.
Okay.
Good thing to point out about that is also this March and April we're offering a special. So for any new Pilates clients or our current class clients who haven't already taken a private, we're offering a special. You can take, I'll read it here because I don't want to get it wrong.
Sure.
It's if you sign up for five private 45-minute sessions at the Wethersfield studio, it's $225 plus tax, so only 45 minutes per session, which is a discount. Your session would have to start again, either in March or April. We only have certain time slots available on Monday because I've partnered, we're doing this with Woodside Therapeutic Massage, another company in Old Wethersfield.
Okay.
And so if you sign up for the five private Pilates classes, you can also get a discounted massage. You can either go for the 45-minute massage for $40 or the 60-minute massage for $60. So Pilates and a massage, if you ask me, I don't think you can beat it, but I might be somewhat partial.
That's okay. My wife would love this. I might take one of these flyers.
Yes, absolutely. And also it's not on the flyer, but for any of our clients who are already taking privates, if they want to do a little bit extra, since they wouldn't be able to get this full deal, they could take a jump board class with us, which is a little more calorie burn, a little more interval training, cheaper price, 25-minute session, you're in, you're out, and mm-hmm. you can also still get in on the woodside massage aspect. So
Very good.
Lots to offer, but very limited time frame because Kim from Woodside and I were both only available Monday mornings to work that together. So
okay, very good. I'm always curious because you're very passionate about all this stuff. How did you get involved with all this?
By accident, although
really?
It maybe shouldn't
okay.
have been.
Okay.
I was a history major, and pursuing that, I went to, I taught high school, and then I worked as assistant director of education at the Mark Twain House for years. They were great jobs, but while I was at the Mark Twain House, I had put on a couple pounds, and so my boyfriend, and I think he made the right decision, bought me a membership to a gym.
Okay.
And I started taking Pilates, and I had done it by video before that. Because I had had some back problems, and it seemed to help. And when the instructor was leaving the gym, she said, you do such a great job, will you take the class? And so they let me start the class without being certified, on the promise that I would get certified. I got certified, I loved it, I started training with the Pilates elders, so they are the people who trained under Joseph Pilates and are in their 80s now and still teaching today. And 2 years after I started the class at the gym, I started Personal Euphoria, and I left the Mark Twain House with one Pilates class, and now we have a bunch. So it was very rewarding, and I'm glad I made that decision.
Wow, the rest is history, I guess.
The rest is history.
Awesome, very good. Well, thank you so much for coming out tonight, Maggie. And for Lauren Servin, I'm Steve Saunders. I'm on this camera. We hope you have a good night, and thanks for watching Healthy Alternatives. I'm sure Lauren will be back next time. Hope so. Have a great night from all of us here at Channel 14.